It's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank the organizers, Tom and Thierry. And I'd like to give you some of our recent work that we've been doing, these collaborators. Daniel is a postdoc in Munich now. Florian is a postdoc at ETH. Stergios is a PhD student at ETH. Mohammed is a former student who's now a postdoc at MIT, soon a faculty member somewhere. And Mattia is a postdoc at Harvard. And just to motivate the title a bit, this is an experiment that either you've seen or you will say, yeah, absolutely, this has to be like this, even though I haven't done this experiment myself. It's just to illustrate what happens when you take a closer look at advection diffusion problems and how transport barriers emerge when you do that. So there's cold water on the left and there's hot water on the right. And under very similar conditions, you put dye of equal, otherwise equal, origin or quality into both, but it's only difference is the color, and just watch what happens. Very soon you will start seeing differences. First, it just comes from the interface, but when you actually speed things up, it's gonna happen faster. Here, this was the sort of the hot water, this is the cold water, and here somehow advection keeps dominating, whereas here diffusion is taking over, and we know that. In general, and we usually talk about the fact that this is now fully mixed or almost fully mixed, if this isn't, but here the point is that not only is it not fully mixed, but very clear interfaces keep not just keep existing, but emerging. And people would generally in this context refer to these very clearly as transport barriers, the idea being that somehow what you see here, a line or a surface, depending on this is two or three dimensional, blocks the transport of the substance that you're mixing into other regions. That's the basic physical idea, and this is what I'd like to elaborate on. And it's just clear that many people would like to understand many problems better. Fundamentally, advection diffusion is governed by the Peckley number, which is the rate, the difference, or the ratio between advective transport rate and the effect of diffusion. It's a non-dimensional number. You need characteristic length scales, velocities, and the diffusivity to describe it. And the thing to keep in mind is that when you have high Peckley number flows, then then advection dominates because of this formula. And when you have low Peckley number flows, then diffusion dominates. So in this experiment, at least, it tells you, which is generally true, when you have high Peckley numbers, then somehow transport barriers, when advection dominates, transport barriers persist during the mixing. Now let's take a larger view. This is Jupiter. It's a picture of the, I think, the currently ongoing space mission. It's a beautiful picture. I find it inspirational. What you're looking at is the atmosphere of Jupiter, which is built out of gases, unlike the fluids we have seen. But invariably, also in this setting, you have very well pronounced structures, which people would love to refer to generally as transport barriers. Again, the idea being that somehow this structure, there for reasons we don't quite understand, the block seems to be blocking the transport, seems to be blocking the tendency of the flow to even itself, right? Having said that, on this slide, I already raised this question because I'm describing this in completely general hand-waving terms. What is really a transport barrier? And when I do that, I also would like to point out that in many problems, say you do an experiment, you do simulations, we spend a lot of energy in getting it right, say running the proper advection diffusion equation to get the right values here, the right values there, the boundary conditions. But what we are really interested in ultimately is actually these structures. We would like to understand the evolution of these structures. We'd like to get a big picture. So very often it pays off to focus on these, even though we do a lot of preparatory work to get the picture right. So the problem, the first problem would be related to that is, even though we're getting to these transport barriers in the overall picture, we have to get somewhere. And what governs the evolution of an advection diffusion problem is the classic advection diffusion equation that I'm showing here. C is a scalar concentration. V is an underlying velocity field. After non-dimensionalization, you have the 1 over Peckley number here, which is essentially the reciprocal of the diffusivity. And in this setting, where advection dominates, and you still, hence you see these transport barriers, the Peckley number is very large. So very often that's the case, in fact, in special environmental flows. The question is whether you can really ignore that even though the Peckley number is very large and hence this number is very small. That's very often done in qualitative studies, that Peckley number is large. can we actually cross this out? And of course, then our natural inclination is to do so in engineering and applied science. But if you're a mathematician, you might get nervous about that, because this is the classic example of a singular perturbation problem. You actually have a small parameter multiplying the highest derivative in your equation. And you'd say, yeah, yeah, but most of the time I'm okay. Some of the time you might be okay, but don't forget that at least in this room right now, our interest is the transport barriers. It's clearly you have high gradients there. So yes, you have a small parameter there, but that term can be alive and well and pretty active, right? So that is a question. Nevertheless, it's routinely done. And and indeed, in nature, there's some justification to that that I just quoted in the literature, some Peclet numbers, they tend to be very high. And especially, say, in the context of the ocean, I looked up some numbers, and of course, it depends on a lot of things. People always give you ranges. But the 10 to the 3, 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 for these numbers, for Peclet numbers, is not uncommon in nature. So that parameter there can be actually tiny. So there's certainly the temptation to ignore that term. Another problem that I also think of as a diffusive problem, or many of us tend to think of, say, related to the ocean, it doesn't start with a diffusive scalar field, such as the plankton population, but it starts with drifters. And this is a plot showing the history of drifters over several years. And I think this was in the Gulf of Mexico. And it does look like a diffusive process, but not in the sense of a diffusive field, but rather a diffusive vector field, like a vector field that has a stochastic component to it. So a lot of us tend to think of these motions as driven by a stochastic differential equation. There are some non-random features in that, if you see these straight lines, but that's simply just outside interference. Somebody found the drifter and then sailed to shore, and right now it's on somebody's pickup trucks, and the person is heading home happily. So those are extreme events in this context. So, but again, the question would be, on this picture, this is not a continental boundary here. This is actually I forget the term when it's referred to, no man's land or dead land, that really the drifters have not entered this area. Okay, and it's clear that there is somehow, in some sense, a transport barrier there. What is exactly that keeps these problems, for these drifters from entering? And again, the underlying problem too would be, related to that, is define and find the transport barriers. Now, not in a PDE, although the two turn out to be related, but in a stochastic differential equation, which has a deterministic drift component, that would be some velocity field that generally you use to model this, plus a diffusion term. So this would be an Itô process. And again, you have your diffusivity there. And the assumption is now, I'm not listing Peclet numbers, but it's very small. And also that this would be a mixture of Brownian motions that you can use to model this. So these are the two problems. Again, the temptation would be to ignore this one. Why, and again, based on the Peclet numbers in nature, or the diffusivity is relevant here, that is not unreasonable. Just quickly, the relationship between this equation and the previous equation, why can I treat them using the same methods? Well, if you take the expected value of the current particle position, a PDF probability density function arises there, and that's a classic result that probability density function satisfies an advection diffusion-like equation, the Fokker-Planck equation. Although if you actually start worrying about the details of this, then it turns out that it's not exactly the equation that I showed you, but it turns out that under some assumptions in compressibility and some assumptions on that B, it does turn out to be an advection diffusion equation. So this would be problem number two. The problem is, what are these things and how do you find them? So define them first and then find them. People have looked at this for a long time, and clearly, as I said, there's a clear inclination to ignore that term, the high derivatives, because the Peclet number in a lot of the cases is very high. And believe it or not, this is how what we call chaotic advection area could be motivated, or this is how that arose. Basically, people said, I still want to understand mixing in these problems, advection-dominated problems, but you know, I don't worry about the mathematicians telling me that you cannot do that. I still think that this is a reasonable assumption. Peclet number is huge, so I'm just going to cross that term out. That's still a complicated transport problem if V has completely general time dependence. So you know what? Let's simplify it to the extent that appropriate techniques from dynamical systems will also apply. And that simplification is a major simplification. Let's actually consider velocity fields that are time periodic. And this was really within the fluid mechanics community This view was very successfully advocated by RF, whose name I'm listing as second, but in fact it's his very influential paper that even gave the name to this approach, chaotic advection. So basically it's only advection, but not only that, I mean, it would still be complicated, but the velocity field is time periodic. So basically when it's time periodic, you can pass to the study of a Poincaré map, a time t map, first return map, and just plot the points of that first return map and see how the system evolves. Very important, however, that the first equation in RF's paper is not that ODE, although we tend to quote RF when we study that, but he was keenly aware of the fact that the underlying problem is the advection diffusion equation. He just says that, you know what, for now, let's make that term zero. And this has been a very active area. And a lot of people, I apologize if I didn't quote some key players there. I tried. There's a very recent, fairly recent review article by first author is the late Hassan RF and a number of other people who talk about the frontiers of chaotic advection. What do they talk about? Essentially, this is a picture from RF's paper. He would run that Poincaré map, iterate that velocity field, a purely advective problem, solve trajectories, and you get a lot of dots. But if you put dots everywhere, if you put initial conditions, then of course you will fill up the whole region, you will not see much. But if you do it with some selectivity, then these barriers will emerge. These are purely advective barriers. And the major contribution of this field was that actually it pointed out what these barriers are. In this case, they are KM, tori, or invariant curves. It means that if you start iterating this Poincaré section on this curve, mapping, then you stay on this curve. So clearly, then people said these curves act as transport barriers. So why don't we call them transport barriers? There are other, I will keep raising that question because I haven't told you what transport barriers are. I gave you an example of what I would like to call a barrier, but I didn't give a definition. There's more to this picture when you blow it up, and this is a picture from Jim Meese's paper. There are details in these chaotic Poincaré maps that are not just these invariant curves, but also stable and unstable manifolds, homoclinic, heteroclinic tangles. It also has some self-similarity. And people refer to all these as transport barriers. But have we really defined by these what transport barriers are? Because you might ask, okay, they are transport barriers, but in what sense? And the usual answer is, well, they are curves that you cannot cross. For instance, if you start inside this curve and you start iterating the Poincaré map, then you will be hopping on that curve and everything that's inside that closed region will stay inside. And if you're happy, that sounds very convincing, right? The only problem is that that's true for any material curve that you pick, right? So I could just pick a circle here right in the middle of this chaotic mass and iterate it once under the Poincaré map. It has elongated, but the fact hasn't changed, and I'm still inside if I started inside. Because this Poincaré map is it's a diffeomorphism. It cannot turn things out from inside out. Generally speaking, material lines, any material line, is a barrier to advective transport. You cannot cross it. The minute you were to cross it, you would be violating uniqueness of solutions. So that's not really an explanation, right? It's a nice observation that these curves have create some regularity, but it doesn't define transport barriers. And anyway, yet you read these articles, the term keeps popping up. Another issue in this area, behind the wonderful, fantastic achievements in this area, but as you try to move forward and apply it to real life flows, you also then start asking questions such as, I actually need lots of observations in principle, mathematically infinite times to construct these curves, where a lot of the problems in nature are very finite time. How do I relate this picture to finite time problems? Okay, and most importantly, this is heavily dependent on the fact that the velocity field is time dependent. What other velocity field would have the property that it, under iterations of its time t map, it keeps iterating the same, mapping at the same circle? Or closed orbit. So many of these fantastically intricate structures are in fact artifacts of this incredibly simple, almost singular time dependence that you can create in the lab, but you will never see in the ocean, for instance, right? Don't forget, right in the middle of this chaotic tangle, there's somewhere a fixed point. Would you expect to see a trajectory in the ocean to come back to the same location at some point and then do this forever? Because that would be a fixed point for the Poincaré map, always with the same return time. unlikely, right? So a lot, the existence of a lot of these beautiful structures is heavily predicated on the fact that the velocity field is heavily idealized. So that's something to keep in mind. So as we're trying to understand is that how do you actually take these concepts and apply them to real life flows that led to this other area that emerged a couple of decades ago, which goes under the name of Lagrangian coherent structures that tries to take these still advective views and extend them to problems that are closer to what you see in nature. So we're still looking at purely advective problems here, but we're no longer assuming that the velocity field is time periodic, and we are actually assuming that it's only given to you in the form of finite time observation. So you don't have infinite times to construct these structures. These structures, stable, unstable manifolds, KM curves, they're all infinite time structures. And this is reality, this is a data set, still completely advective, not no diffusion, but at least it doesn't make those idealizations. So then what are we looking for when we look for transport barriers? Still an advective problem. So this is sort of a dust barrier here that emerges from this twister. And if you look closer, I don't know if you can see it from there, it has a beautiful hole in it. It's like the eye of the storm. So it does look like a KM type surface, a Kolmogorov-Arnold-Moser type surface with an invariant circle associated with it, except that it's not invariant anymore. This structure would move, and this structure, this circle is, never was a circle exactly, this closed orbit will, close too, will actually deform. But somehow, we still would like to call it informally as a transport barrier because somehow it keeps its integrity even though it doesn't repeat periodically. So then people have started calling these coherent structures. So they would simply say that in this setting, transport barriers or Lagrangian coherent structures would be material surfaces that do not come back to themselves and may even do not come back at all even close to their original location, but at least they keep their integrity, they keep their coherence in some sense, right? And that's the point where I'm starting to hand wave because I really haven't said in what sense. And that's really why all the people, and again, my apologies again if I haven't listed some people who work in this area, but everybody in this area is keen on defining what that notion of coherence is because there's no universally accepted notion of coherence. So, and therefore everybody has their own methods that they advocate and then compare different problems, how well those methods do. But again, the idea would be find these types of surfaces from the analysis, finite time analysis of an aperiodic velocity field. So I did a review on this a few years ago, but this is still an active area. So I just list a few of these. There will be no time to go through them. If you know them, then perhaps the formula reminds you of what they do, but I will just read their titles. So people use finite time Yapunov exponents, finite size Yapunov exponents. These generate fields. I call these methods diagnostic because they don't actually tell you what these structures are, but if you run these algorithms on velocity fields, then a scalar field emerges as an output and people would look at features of that scalar field. That's why I call them diagnostic, okay? So there's some proposal. It's a good idea to look at the scalar field and then people visually identify these structures. So like I said, finite time, Yapunov exponents, finite size, trajectory length. So they all are argued in these papers that they should be relevant. The eigenvalues, the mesochronic analysis would look at the eigenvalues of the deformation gradient, which is the derivative of the flow map that will also come up later. You can talk about various notions of trajectory complexity and calculate scalar fields related to that. Talk about shape coherence, which is related to the change of curvature of certain material objects. The transfer operator approach that in simplest form would talk about coherent pairs, which basically you take an initial set and map it forward under the flow map and then in fact map it back and see how much they differ. Well, they don't differ at all, right, under normal circumstances. So what people do that before mapping it back, they apply some noise here, and then they map back after some noise. That noise is then sort of artificially introduced. It's not the original diffusion. And they look at the mismatch between the two. And then fuzzy C-means clustering, which is a way of applying graph theoretical methods to find close trajectories in a tree or hierarchy or a graph built by trajectories. There's other ways of doing that, the spectral clustering. I was involved in these. This is a geodesic LCS construction, which beyond the formulas just means that you look at some functional that describes either stretching or shear in the flow, and you try to find stationary curves of that functional. And finally, this is LAVD, Lagrangian averaged vorticity deviation. There's a theory behind that which tells you in the end that if you take the spatial mean of the vorticity at any point in time, you subtract it from the vorticity and take its norm and integrate it along trajectories. But again, certain level sets of that should delineate certain coherent structures. So everybody has their own opinions, okay? And we did a comparison on these not long ago, and this is a two-dimensional turbulence simulation, and we ran all the methods. And the first, when you actually just do sort of preliminary assessment, they say, one could say, oh great, actually there are similar features, but when you start, the more you look at the details, the more they start to differ. And if you really would like to use these methods for prediction, say making a decision about resource allocation because there's an environmental emergency and you want to really rely on this, then you become uncertain which one to pick because some of the predictions can be very different from others, right? And you could say, well, still, I mean, let's be optimistic. I mean, these methods are still capturing something, right? Because the structure is emerging and some of them are consistent with structures in the others. So clearly the arguments behind these methods are working, right? And you were enthusiastic until you actually ran this on a completely randomly chosen scalar field behind which there's no argument. And I just asked my students to evaluate sine 2x or something and sine times, what was it, sine 2x times sine 2y on the final positions and plot them over the initial positions. And you get a pretty picture. One could argue that this is the best picture of all, right? So. Just the fact that you put something in the flow, a Lagrangian trace, a Lagrangian indicator, and it starts showing patterns, it doesn't mean that you have actually explained what the reason behind those patterns was. I mean, these things are called Lagrangian coherent structures for a reason. Anything you put in the flow will, sooner or later, show a footprint of these structures. But the fact that I put creamer in my coffee, and the creamer starts showing pattern, that fact, that the creamer itself doesn't explain the patterns in the flow. Rather, it's a diagnostic, it's an indicator. So there's clearly that by itself, that we can produce pretty pictures, doesn't really explain what those structures are or in what sense they are transport barriers, right? So just given this comparison, we just felt that perhaps we should really go back to the original problems, because this is a great, very active area. People keep churning out their definitions of coherent structures. Some have definitions, others, in fact, most just offer diagnostic tools, but we're not really converging on a single approach. We really haven't said what transport barriers are, and the results actually also keep differing. Why? Because if we have changed the original problem and we then entered the land of coherent structure definitions, which there isn't a universal one of which, right? So if we go back to the original problem, that's a hard problem, but in fact the chance emerges that we can do actually something about solving these problems uniquely. So back to the original problem. This was the original problem, and I consider it in a bit more general form now. So we have an advection diffusion for the concentration C, and this was the classic advection diffusion part that I've given you, but I've also thrown in some additional terms. I also allow for sources and sinks. That's clearly relevant in applications. For instance, you have an oil spill developing and it continues to be fed by a source, then you need to be able to include source terms there. Or as I learned from biological applications, but even as I understand from the study of an oil spill, very often you have some natural decay to the concentration. It's a spontaneous decay, and that can also be time dependent. So this is the most general equation we can deal with. It's also a very hard equation. It's no longer an ODE problem. It's a PDE problem because those derivatives are back. And actually, I pose this in any dimension now. It actually does not make too much difference. The diffusivity, I will assume it's small, but it's there. And now there's a general diffusivity structure tensor, which also is used in a lot of areas. The only assumption that I make on that, it can actually even be spatial and temporally dependent, but it has to be symmetric and positive definite for this to make physical sense, as it turns out. So this is the problem that I'd like to look at, and I'd like to state the objects among which I will try to find those barriers. So first, I'd like to narrow the study out of all possible surfaces and dimensions to material surfaces. And why would I do that? Material surfaces are, or invariant manifolds in space-time, are surfaces that have some initial positions. So this is, say, a bunch of fluid trajectories in, say, in three dimensions. In two dimensions, it's a curve. And I simply take the flow map and generated by the velocity field, and I let them go in time. So this is a deformed version of the material surface. And I'm going to be looking for transport barriers. I'm going to say what transport barriers are in a second. But I'm only going to be looking at surfaces that have this material evolution. And why do I do that? I do that because if I pick material surfaces, I've already knocked out the major component of any possible transport through them, which is advection. There's no material advection through a material surface. Okay, so that is out. So I'm just looking at the rest of the effect of these terms, primarily the rest of the effect of diffusion, and try to find among material surfaces the ones that I want to call transport barrier based on that. Again, the notation is initial position advected by the flow map from T naught to T. That's the current position of the material surface. All right. And instead of giving you a complicated principle, a functional, an operator, or any of that we have done in the area of LCSEs, I'm just going to give you one sentence, and hopefully everybody will agree. So a material barrier to diffusive transport would simply be, if it comes up, a material surface that inhibits transport more than its neighbors do. That's it. Okay. So I would argue that the reason why you see this particular surface here emerging, because this continuity and in finite time flows, so surfaces have actually very similar properties over finite time intervals, which I'm looking at, but somehow that surface blocks transport more than its neighbors. So if you start twisting that surface and you start measuring transport through them, then you will find that they're not blocking it as effectively as this one. And the advantage of this one is that everybody agrees on the notion of transport through a surface that's well-defined. And the chemical engineer would say the same thing, a mechanical engineer, fluid mechanician, atmospheric scientist, this is transport 101. It doesn't depend on anybody's coherence principle or understanding of coherence. It's very quantitative. So even if your interest is in fact just purely advective mixing, you can take this definition and after that take the kappa goes to zero purely advective limit, and whatever transpires would be your transport barrier. This is unambiguous because the transport through a surface is very well defined, and it's also robust because we are constructing it in a robust environment. There's noise added to it to begin with, and it's quantitative. The transport through the surface is a number. You can compute it, and you just say that if something is a local extremizer of that transport, then you have a barrier. So that's a clear definition. Any disagreement on that? Yeah, there's already one, so I overstated my case. Yeah. So it's material advection. So it's the flow map that you obtain by just considering the vector field, the velocity field, just this purely material advection. That's why I'm calling it material surface, right? Really. Any other questions? Okay. All right. So this is I won't have time to discuss this whole. So there's now a whole set of results on this, and I'm just going to look at the simplest case, which I call unconstrained diffusion barriers for reasons that I tell you in a second. I'm going to set the sinks and sources to zero. So right now, this is the simplest case, and there's no spontaneous decay either. So no sources, no sinks, and no decay. So the classic advection diffusion situation. Here's what I was talking about. That it's very. This is now the classic thing that we, in some sense, always wanted to do in this field, but never had the courage to do because it involves PD analysis. Okay. So we have a material surface. We have just clarified that that's a purely advected set of fluid particles. And we have a flux vector for the diffusion through it. This is, again, universally agreed upon. That's the gradient under a Fickian diffusion model of C times the diffusion structure tensor that can depend on space and time and some small diffusivity. So the structure of the diffusion is in D, and this is just a small number to indicate that overall this flux is small, and this is a moving material surface. So what's the transport through that surface? This is again a classic formula that we all would agree on. The transport through that evolving material surface, it's already determined fully by its initial position because it's involved under a deterministic velocity field. It's just the integral of the flux vector dotted with the surface normal, okay, that's pointwise, the flux, and I integrate that over the whole surface. The surface is evolving. That's again instantaneous flux globally through the surface. To get actually transport, I also need to take the time integral of that. That's it. Okay. So first integration over the surface, and then integration over time. And actually, I can reformulate, I can sort of interchange these two, and I can reformulate this in a complicated function that I'm not going to show you. But that formulation includes now parametrization of that codimension one surface. So I'm interested in surfaces that have dimension one less than the ambient space, because those have the potential to act as barriers. Lower dimensional surfaces don't, right? So this has some intrinsic parametrization. I'm not going to go into that. And the reason I've written everything else as L, because this is going to be a calculus of variations problem. I'm looking at a surface that extremizes, or at least stationarizes, this transport functional. So a Lagrangian will emerge. It's a nasty problem in the end, but the structure of it is a classic calculus of variations problem. Now over the initial surface, because once you have the initial surface, then the velocity field uniquely determines how that evolves, right? So select now, in order to solve this problem, I need to figure out exactly how things are here, especially how the gradient evolves from its initial concentration. That somehow comes in this Lagrangian. And then I'm going to make an assumption that I'm going to look at the most diffusion-prone initial concentration for each material surface that I'm looking at. So I'm taking each material surface one by one. That's what the calculus of variations does. And along that material surface, I'll just say, you know, I don't actually care what the initial concentration was. I don't even know in most cases, but I'm going to assume the worst, which means the one that produces the highest degree of diffusion. So I'm going to align the initial concentration gradient everywhere with the normal of that surface. So that's very good for diffusion, right, as opposed to some tangential one. And it points to the surface normal is outward. So assume that there's very high concentration here and practically zero concentration there, and the gradient is normal. It points in this direction because it points in the direction of the high concentration, which means I'm creating a level playing field for all surfaces. Everybody's subjected to the same nasty diffusion environment. The diffusion has all the power because the gradient is normal. And then I want to select the surface that resists that the most. Okay? So it's a fair. So I don't want a surface to lose just because there was no concentration in that area. Because in some other situation, the same surface can be very active once I actually have non-trivial gradients there. So that's the only assumption I'm making. And that enables me then to go through this analysis when I, as we always do in fluid mechanics, we would also like to non-dimensionalize. So I non-dimensionalize with everything I can, with the diffusivity, with the time interval, with the normal of this. I should, because I selected that anyway, arbitrarily, but also by the area. These factors I'm non-dimensionalizing with because I don't want a surface to win because it's large. Clearly, through large surfaces, you will have large transport, okay? And I certainly don't want one surface to win because incidentally, that gradient that I have chosen was high there. So I'm knocking all these out. It's a pure competition about pure quality of blocking diffusion. That's what it's all about. And that's this transport zero functional. And I just want to find stationary surfaces of that really, when they're maximizers or when they're minimizers, they block the transport as much as they can. So that's a variational problem, an involved one, okay? Because it's parameterized by n minus one variables. But ultimately, that will be my barrier, the solution of that problem. It turns out to be actually a null surface of a Lorentzian tensor field. There's some beautiful geometry behind that I'm not going to go into that. But this would be the answer to the question that we have posed under very equal conditions for all material surfaces, and it's the solution in n dimensions. Again, there's a lot of math going into this, which I'm not listing, but I hope that conceptually you find this very simple. It's just that it was very hard to do. For years, we really didn't look at this problem at all because it involves really now higher dimensional calculus of variation problems, analysis of PDEs, and so on. But fundamentally, this is the surface that we're looking for. Any questions on this? Yeah.
So you do you first have your initial concentration and then you choose a barrier, or you choose one M0 and then you construct an initial field?
Okay, so it's a good question. So when you do the calculus of variations approach, then you always take a candidate surface and you try to perturb from that surface, so to speak. That's what the analysis does. That's what leads to Euler-Lagrange equations. And C, under what values do you get that original surface was stationary? So at this point, I don't know this surface. That will be output of this. Okay. But even without knowing it, I can say that whatever it is, the local concentration distribution initially is like this. Okay. But the whole construct here, when I get to this functional, will still depend on that surface that I don't know.
So you don't define C0 is defined just at
C0 is constant.
Defined only at
C0 in this approach, in the unconstrained one, okay, I assume that actually nobody knows what the initial concentration was, okay?
And this is sufficient.
This is one approach. In a lot of the problems, when you look at the currently evolving concentration, you don't actually know what the initial concentration was. And you actually, most of the time, don't just want to understand barriers with respect to that particular scalar evolution, right? Because next, maybe, you know, a year later, there might be in a similar situation another oil spill there, or you might have plankton again in the next season. So it's not so much that the current evolution for the current initial concentration, rather than the structures in the flow that create barriers. That's what your interest is, right? Okay. But I agree with you, there could be a situation when you say, hey, I have this particular, say, oil spill, or whatever plankton configuration, and I'd like to understand the barriers with respect to that. That would be the constrained version, which I don't think I have time for that, but this is the unconstrained. Okay, any other question? So that the question is in this, in some sense, that? Yeah, I didn't.
Yeah, so it's what you're trying to do is calculate the effective diffusion field, which would be sort of infinite where you have these barriers, or so zero at these barriers, and then you can then apply that to any concentration field afterwards.
I didn't want to use the word effective diffusion because there are other procedures that people use for computing effective diffusion. This is very much based on an exact analysis of the analysis of material surfaces, right? But I think it's a fair characterization what you're saying, is that indeed diffusion, the actual magnitude of diffusion is out of the picture. It's going to zero, in fact. And what remains there is the diffusion structure that I haven't taken out. So that is embedded into this quantity, okay? All right, so again, this is a functional, and it's stationary surfaces are the transport barriers. It's well-defined, and very importantly, you don't have to solve the advection diffusion equation to solve this problem. That's really the value of this, because in this integral, once I have fixed the initial concentration gradients like that, it's only the velocity field you need to know and the diffusion structure tensor. You don't never have to do a PD simulation to actually solve this problem. It's an ODE problem plus the diffusion structure. Okay. This has a formalism, what the solutions are for n dimensions, but I'm just going to give you those in two dimensions. But the solution exists, and we can sort of write it down in three dimensions and higher, any dimensions, in fact. It's just that computationally, the easiest is the two-dimensional case. So in two dimensions, you can actually explicitly solve this problem. And if you have a two-dimensional velocity field, then the solution, the material surface, will be a specific trajectory of an ordinary differential equation. And that ordinary differential equation is drawn, it's if this is your initial time slice here, so this is sort of space, and this is time, no, this is still space. So say x1, x1, say x01, x02, so this is your sort of physical initial configuration, and say time is shooting out in that direction. So you had some surface here that now then evolves. It could be closed, could be open, right? This is your barrier surface. Then what I'm after is this curve, because once I have the initial position of the barrier, I can just use the velocity field to advect it, given that it's material. So that curve, based on the initial configuration, it's a solution of this ODE, where prime is not time, but an intrinsic parametrization of that curve. Okay? And to calculate that ODE, you have to have information. The velocity field is given to you, so you can run the flow map. And this, you have to take the gradient of the flow map. It involves the diffusivity structure tensor. Again, the flow map, the determinant of that. This is a tensor field that you need to average. And we refer to that as C bar D. If you know Lagrangian say, continuum mechanics, then this is a version of the Cauchy-Green strain tensor, except that it also contains the diffusivity. So the answer that we're giving to this problem is starting to pull in the diffusion, even though the quantities are advection-based. So when we had initial concerns about this being a singular perturbation problem in the end, even when you set the advection to zero, those concerns were well justified. Because even when you push the diffusivity to zero, these formulas that I'm presenting to you, even in the limit of purely advective mixing, they will contain the diffusion structure tensor. That's the classic manifestation of a singular perturbation problem. So the correct answer, you can't really take the diffusivity first and look for to zero first and look for transport barriers and then say that what I have found is actually the answer for small diffusivities. No, you have to solve the problem for small diffusivities and then take the diffusion equals zero limit, even if your interest is purely advective mixing. And here's a manifestation of that. The diffusivity structure tensor will be stuck there in the answer, right? But anyway, so this is diffusion independent now, also independent, also holds in the limit of zero diffusion. So you need to calculate this averaged modified Cauchy-Green strain tensor, and this C1 and C2 are the eigenvectors of the tensor field, and lambda 1 and lambda 2 here are the eigenvalues. And the T0 turns out to be a Lagrange multiplier. This just governs, it's a parameter, it's up to you. There's a whole one parameter family of ODEs that you can look at. It governs the strength of the diffusion. So in the class that you're playing and comparing potential candidates for barriers, T0 would be, in that class, the pointwise transport density for those. So it's a one-parameter family of differential equations that describes these curves. You can solve these very quickly on the plane and say, depending on your interest, if you're really interested in closed curves, then you can look for closed barriers. You can look for limit cycles of that. If you're interested in open curves, then you can look at special solutions that say they look like stable and unstable manifolds of saddle points and so on. So this time-independent ODE somehow encodes everything here, encodes everything that's going to happen in time, and maps it back here. You do the analysis here, and after that, you just advect it forward, and that's your answer to the barrier problem. It also turns out if you don't want to do all this, how do I go forward? Sorry. Out of this analysis emerges a scalar field, but that's no longer a simply heuristic diagnostic scalar field. The tracer of this tensor actually is related to the second variation of the functional, and it tells you that the strongest barriers are have high values of this DBS. So what it is just the trace of this tensor. So you can either mess with this ODE, you can solve it very quickly these days, right, and find structures in it, or you just plot this diagnostic field, which is not heuristic, but rather it comes out from a rigorous second variation argument. So this is what happens when you say apply this to an ocean velocity field that our favorite is for mesoscale phenomena. So it's the satellite altimetry-based sea surface height field from which, under the geostrophic assumption, you can derive velocities. And we actually, from a number of studies, we have happened to focus for a number of years for Agulhas rings in this area where Agulhas rings at the southern tip of Africa are created and they move forward. And for various reasons, they're even related to climate. I don't want to go into this because I don't know much about it. But I have seen a number of papers and questions posed about these rings, which at some intuitive levels clearly exist in the Eulerian frame. But the question is how much of, say, salty water or warm water do they transport from the southern tip of Africa, because that has a crucial role in some later interaction that happens northwards. And to that effect, it would be very important to actually find the material barriers that enclose those higher salt concentrations and temperature concentrations, but define them in a way which is defendable. It doesn't depend on somebody's coherence principle, but it really depends just on the ability of these surfaces to block diffusion or not block diffusion, because the quantities of interest here are not just water per se, but attributes of water, say how salty it is or how warm it is. So we want to find diffusion barriers, really, not just advective transport barriers. So anyway, to make a long story short, when you get the satellite data and apply this, then these limit cycles that I have just told you can be very quickly computed. There's many of them, and those will be the transport barriers to diffusion. So these are eddies that are mesoscale, so that their size can be, you know, 150, 200, or even 300 kilometers. And we now have an exact result that what you see here, they are actually limit cycles of that field, so they are exact transport barriers. So if you perturb these initial material surfaces just by a small amount, and then you let go, then the resulting surface, as it evolves, blocks diffusion always to a lesser extent than these do. So these are the winners. These are the theoretical barriers. What you see in the background is this diagnostic field, which doesn't give you all the details, but already gives you a very accurate assessment of the other structures. So you see that without solving all the trajectories of the ordinary differential equation, there are some open barriers here as well. In fact, a lot of the things that people have suspected, these would be the other candidates for those Agulhas rings, except that they don't hold water, so to speak. They don't hold the water attributes. So the ones that are really transporting them in a coherent fashion as diffusion barriers are these and not the others. So there's a systematic overestimation that we have found in the literature of the amount of transport in that region. It's in fact a fraction of that. So these do spin water as well, but they don't hold them, hold these water attributes in a coherent fashion. So let's see if these predictions were actually meaningful. So what Daniel did, my collaborator, took some of these and also placed shifted images of these here and put the very high concentration in these. This is the initial concentration distribution. And then would let the whole flow evolve. And now he is actually solving an advection diffusion equation. To get the prediction, we didn't need advection diffusion equations. This is purely from the velocity field and the diffusion structure tensor. But here now you will be seeing a validation of these results with this diffusivity, which is realistic. And some of these are real and others are fake. And I will leave it to you to see which one is real, which one is fake. What you will be seeing here, however, is the results in the Lagrangian frame, meaning that instead of seeing these patches evolve under advection and diffusion, we factored out advection. So we're showing the current, when a trajectory leaves from here, we show the current configuration, the current concentration along that trajectory over its initial configuration, all right? So it's in Lagrangian coordinates. You will not see these moves. You can imagine traveling with these. You will not see any deformation, but we will be mapping back the current configuration of the trajectory starting from that point, the current concentration along that trajectory to that point, and update the initial picture. And you could see, I would have thought that for such small diffusivities, you won't see much, but the effect of pure diffusion is just amazing. This diffusion is actually enhanced by local stretching and completely destroys the fake ones. Whereas the real ones, these are the real ones, just look how resilient they are. And they are diffusing, so they're letting the concentration through, but they do it in a very controlled fashion, whereas everybody else is getting destroyed. So these are really the barriers. And very sharply, this methodology gives you what the barriers are. You can then also take the same velocity field and say, you know what? I don't want to put a scalar field on it. I would like to understand the uncertainty associated with this whole situation. So I'm just going to take the velocity field and look at an Itô process into which I feed the satellite velocities in here, and I add diffusion there. And again, that's something else that in the chaotic advection literature we have not been able to, or in the LCS literature, deal with. What is the, how do you quantify uncertainty in assessing these barriers? We're doing that now, okay? So again, if you pass the Lagrangian coordinates, meaning that you take the solutions of the stochastic differential equation and you parameterize them by their initial condition, then you can transform this Itô process to its Lagrangian coordinate version. So it's posed on the initial configuration. And that's then the corresponding ODE. So again, what you will see in this simulation, here there are some fake ones here, and Daniel is releasing points. This is not scalar field anymore that he's releasing, but initial concentrations, but they are subject to noisy advection. And from the real ones, we should not be seeing a whole lot of transport out, only diffusive transport, but from the others, there should be enhanced transport, and that's exactly what happens. So this is now the sort of the uncertainty analysis of the velocity field very quickly, as you see. Again, in real life, these material blobs are moving, but we have eliminated the convection part. We're only showing the diffusion part. And look at what happens to the fake ones, and look at what happens to the real ones. Very beautifully, yes, diffusion noise is at play, so you do get out, but in a controlled fashion. So my last slide is just a summary of this. So we now have a rigorous prediction tool for these barriers, for the ones that we originally wanted. These are barriers to diffusion. These are some other problems in which we have calculated them in two and also in three dimensions now. And these are unique and robust structures. If your interest is still coherent structures in a purely advective limit, even then, this now gives a unique definition for those. Because what would be the definition? These are coherent structures or material surfaces that, under the slightest addition of diffusion or uncertainty, will prevail as diffusion barriers, even if you didn't have any diffusion in the original problem. So it's sort of a universal definition. It's universal because we didn't need a diffusion value to compute these. We didn't need to know the initial concentration. We didn't have to solve the PDE. And also, we didn't have to bother with the boundary conditions that arise. And that's really the hairy part for solving these. People just postulate boundary conditions. So this is virtually a conference about challenges. So the challenges, there's more, but I just pick two here. Clearly, whenever I present this, the next question is always, OK, this is all about passive diffusion barriers. What about barriers to the diffusion of active matter, which are not even scalars, but vectors, say vorticity or momentum, and some even say energy. And I do think that's very important. It's a challenge, because these quantities, I didn't go into objectivity, but everything we do here is frame independent, and it heavily uses that principle. So it means that whatever we get as results should be independent of the observer, because it's all about material properties. Whereas these quantities are fundamentally frame dependent. So how do you modify the machinery? I don't want to modify the machinery. I'd like to get results that are frame independent. So rather, how do you modify these quantities so that their transport becomes frame independent and objectively describable? And also computation from experimental data, that's something they were working on, and also visualization in 3D. That's actually some preliminary result in these directions. This is a cross-section of a three-dimensional channel flow. And these are now, we are still working on the visualization, it's a preliminary step to highlight barriers to the diffusive transport of vorticity in three dimensions. That's a whole separate theory. But we're getting there. Also, we also now know how to do this, but I'm not going to talk about the momentum about that now. So that's where I'm going to stop. Thank you.
Thank you. We have questions.
So, George, that's very thought-provoking. I have a question, I guess, about kind of existence and uniqueness kind of statements. So if such barriers are there, your algorithmic approach will find them. Can you a priori, is there any way you know before looking for them whether they're likely to be there or not? And also, is there any risk of a kind of false positive that the algorithm will identify something that isn't really a barrier?
Right, thank you. That's certainly a very relevant question. So I think the answer to the first one is that this diagnostic field that you see in the background, that was the trace of that modified Cauchy-Green tensor field, does give you a quick assessment. So you don't have to invest much numerically, and that would give you a general idea of where you should be looking at more closely, right? So you don't have to spend much effort. Even then, solving it, say, a two- or three-dimensional ODE like this is not a huge effort anyway. Now, in terms of false positive and false negatives, I think that would only come from this part. So if you do have to compute quantities, they have their own uncertainties associated with them, and that's the only place where I could see false positives and negatives coming if you have hugely inaccurate data. However, on the plus side, this is already a noisy theory. It includes diffusion, right? So in that sense, it's very robust, right? So you really have to have major inaccuracies in your data to get it wrong. But as always, with any data-driven, data-based approach, if your data is really bad, then you're going to have problems. Other than that, calculus of variations procedure is well-defined. It gets you all the stationary surfaces. It will not miss any of them, right?
Hi, thank you. That was very impressive. I don't know much about this topic, but I've told you I have a constant discussion with Goose Jacobs, who'd work with you. And we thought about using some of these ideas to identify in three dimensions coherent structures near a bottom boundary due to boundary layers that separate by the passage of an internal wave or a surface wave. And as I teach my numerical analysis class to the undergrads, at one level you have to get the mathematical formalism right, but then implementing it on a computer and understanding how operators go from continuous to discrete form and all the implementation challenges is a whole other chapter. So when we thought about doing FDLE type of analysis on 3D grids, I know there's grid deformation issues, there's all sorts of challenges. Of all these methods that you described in 3D, like what is the state of the art right now to look at, you know, start identifying structures in turbulence?
Well, the state of the art is this, clearly. Just kidding. So there is a reason why I'm presenting this, because all these years we've been working towards perfecting these methods. But again, I recall the slide, which is partly frustrating, is that there's all this parallel development without any consensus.
Okay.
I think the reason is that all these principles have their own domain of definition, their own philosophy, and they don't seem to be converging. And one performs better on some model, the other performs on another one. But there's actually no real way to assess which one is better, because you do the computation, different algorithms on the same data set, mm-hmm. and you say, hey, yours is not giving what mine is giving. But the other person will say, yeah, but what I'm finding satisfies my definition of a barrier or a coherent structure. And then that's how things were. So the idea was here to basically get a common platform, get a common ground, somehow a concept that we all agree on, which is independent of these principles. And it's independent whether somebody's favorite is FDLE or something else, and just deal with the truth and compute that, right? And as long as we agree on what transport through a surface is, this is the answer, okay?
Okay.
Now these scalar fields, they do need to be computed. In any Lagrangian study, you have to have a good accuracy for computing Lagrangian trajectories and the derivatives. So I think the minute you decide that you're interested in material structures, there will be necessarily numerical efforts that you have to make. But I think given today's computing environment, even GPUs, parallel computing capabilities, solving a three-dimensional particle advection is not that bad. This is the result of that. This is a turbulent channel flow, three-dimensional.
Okay.
Pretty bad, right? Still from DNS, so with the resolution of the DNS, and this is computable. It's a cross-section of that. Where I see, actually, in fact, the bigger challenge, I think, is the visualization. You now have whatever, terabytes of data, okay. and some surfaces are in there embedded. How do you really then extract them? Whatever principle you have will involve some assessment of surfaces, and how do you visualize them effectively? That's where I would see the challenge.
But in computation, it seems that you're boiling it down to like doing the Lagrangian particle tracking.
I think that's the key challenge. That's always the most costly part. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you.
So what I see out of this is a possibility. So state of the art allows us to have inner system models, eddy resolving or eddy permitting type models, but state of the practice isn't necessarily that. So what I can see from this is that if you're not permitting eddies, or you're not permitting mesoscale eddies, and you're not taking into account something like this, you're going to maybe over or underestimate what the diffusivity of this, effective diffusivity of this tracer is. Because your tracer is now, because it's stuck in these material or in these areas, it's preferentially sampling that flow and that flow only and not the rest of the flow around that, which has implications for reactive tracers and other things like that and material transport. So I'm wondering, have you thought about how this could be incorporated into how this can be better parameterized? I mean, I know this is an identification thing, but say for instance, as Colin said, a predictor for this, looking at the flow. So is there a way to predict this so say for instance, you just have one grid box that covers this whole thing, and you just have a mean value. Is there some way to predict something like that based upon mean values or larger scale values? Does that make sense?
Okay, so again, just back to basics. I think people very much used to say, when you talk about effective diffusivity, that you do have to solve the problem and diagnose it afterwards. Even effective diffusivity or this equivalent diffusivity calculations, they they take the result of a diffused configuration and try to find things in there. We're not using any of that. This is predictive. This only uses the velocity field and a known diffusivity structure tensor that somebody gives me. If they say it's molecular diffusion, then it's just the identity. There's no analysis of the scalar field involved. It's a purely advective analysis giving you diffusive conclusions, right? So I didn't quite get the fact that we're restricting the analysis to the, we're not restricting. This is running on the whole ocean region of interest, right? This emerges as the main player from a global analysis. We're not targeting just one structure here. We don't, if we want, we can just run the diagnostic field, and this could be part of the diagnostic field and say, okay, there's probably clearly something in this region because there's lower values of the diagnostic field, so why don't we actually refine the analysis there? We could do that, but you could just globally run both, right? So I don't see that restriction. So in the sense that I think of prediction, this is predicting for you what's going to happen when you actually start running a costly diffusive simulation or a costly Monte Carlo simulation with lots of realizations just based on the velocity field. And the analysis of the velocity field, as far as I can tell, is cheap. If the velocity field is not well resolved, of course, yeah, I can only work with the data that you're giving me. But whatever resolution.
Say, for instance, you are not. You're not resolving the Agulhas rings. How can you then predict maybe something like this is going to happen? Does that make sense? Like, if you don't have a well-resolved velocity field, which is often the case, what do you do?
I would have thought that if you don't have a well-resolved velocity field, then you can't really predict anything, right? It's always relative to the data that you have, right? So this reminds me of these movies, you know, the action movies when you can read the license plate and details of the license for huge distances in dark and everything, you know, they have a blurred image and then the action hero asks the nerd guy, the expert, can you work on this for me? I say, yeah, wait a second, wait. And refines and finally it emerges with incredible clarity. I don't hold on. I don't have that kind of.
Okay. Thank you very much. We have no time anymore for the break, the questions.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.